Coming up on this week's news, the IET urgently clarifies the rules on the rated current of consumer units following reports of poor practice in the trade. A contracting firm is fined £120,000 after a solar panel installer falls from a roof in Salisbury. And the government unveils plans to make public charger installations easier. Welcome back after the winter break to Electrical News Weekly in association with Solar Trade Sales, your easy one-stop shop for all things solar. Remember to click the link in the show notes to check out their online shop. Whether you're listening in the van, on site or down at the wholesale counter, I'm Joe Robinson and I've been through the best of the electrical industry news to save you the trouble. And if you think you've spotted the two words that I've been challenged to slip into this week's show, comment with them below for the chance to win a prize. The authors of the wiring regulations have moved to clarify the rated current requirements of consumer units as more and more householders install microgeneration. The Institution of Engineering and Technology published its guidance this week in a bid to reduce the instances where ratings could be exceeded. The organisation gives the example of a microgenerator, such as a solar panel installation with a maximum current of 16 amps connected to a 100 amp unit. This fails regulation 551.7.2 as the assembly current could hit 116 amps. One solution is for electricians to request that the DNO cutout fuse is downgraded to 80 amps. This works, but it limits the capacity of the board. An alternative is to swap the board for one rated at 125 amps. While expensive and disruptive, it complies with the regs. Another option is a board from a manufacturer which can handle both supplies, but requires them at different ends of the busbar. Remember, a busbar can have a different rating to the whole assembly. In this case, the manufacturer must ensure the consumer unit can distribute the 116 amps without overheating. Such an arrangement is likely to be subject to the application of a rated diversity factor. This is to account for the mutual heating of circuits and devices. Where this is the case, the IET cautions that electricians must obtain a declaration from the manufacturer and attach it to the electrical certificate. A final allowable option is to install an overcurrent protective device immediately upstream of the disboard. You then connect the solar panel's inverter to the AC supply immediately upstream of this device using a 100 amp connector block. The guidance also explores overload coordination with an overcurrent protection device. More advanced solutions, such as a customer limitation scheme using load shedding relays, are included in Amendment 4 of the regulations, which has now concluded its period of public consultation. I've put the link to the detailed guidance document in the show notes, as well as a link to the free training package that we made on this very subject, supported by the good folks at Ludham Palazzoli. It's worth a watch and will count towards your annual CPD requirement, so check it out. In other news, the government has announced plans to make it easier to install EV chargers in public locations. The Department for Transport is scrapping the need for installers of plug-in points to get a Section 50 licence to do the work. Instead, charge point operators should use a permit, which officials say would be much quicker and cheaper. Typically, applications for EV charger jobs that last 3 days or fewer need to be sent within 3 days of when the work needs to start, and the Highway Authority must respond within 2 days. The maximum permit fee that can be charged is either £45 or £60 depending on the type of road. Charge point operators will also be able to access the online street manager platform across England to notify the local highway authority. The government says it will also allow off-street EV chargers to be installed in homes using permitted development rights. The loosening of the planning rules comes following reports that the UK is on the cusp of a charge point revolution. That's because the number of plug-in stations is set to increase dramatically in the next 2 years. More than 120 planning applications for plug points worth more than £500 million have been granted in the last 18 months by local authorities. That equates to hundreds of thousands of new points. Projects given the green light include a £100 million job for a charger network across Wales and a £68 million project for West Sussex Council. Schemes costing £692 million have been approved recently in a sign that local officials are heeding advice from central government that charging infrastructure should get priority. It's also been a record year for sales of electric vehicles. In 2024, almost one in five cars sold was purely electric. The growth was dominated by businesses, not private individuals. The sales are partly driven by discounting from auto brands who are trying to avoid government penalties. Meanwhile, one such brand, Nissan, has become the latest to announce it will include bi-directional charging in some of its cars from next year. Cars equipped with its vehicle-to-grid technology will be able to use their batteries to power the home or sell energy back to the grid. The company has become the first in the UK to gain what's called G99 certification. A G99 cert is needed to supply electricity electricity to the UK network. Nissan says that going bidirectional can cut the annual cost of powering an EV by 50%. Now, an exciting update from the Luceco Group. As part of their ongoing commitment to support electricians, they've relaunched their online training academy with courses on all manner of subjects, from electrical design to fire alarms to EV charger installs. And don't worry, you don't need to be bilingual in tech speak, as many of the courses are presented by a familiar face. Click the link in the show notes to see all the courses available to help you with your CPD. In the courts this week, a contracting firm has been fined £120,000 after a solar panel installer plunged from a roof in Salisbury in Wiltshire. The man, who was 23 at the time, broke his leg in the fall while working for EE Renewables Limited in December 2022. He had been adjusting a solar panel when he slid and fell 4 metres onto the ground below. A health and safety executive probe found that the company had not properly planned the work at height and it had failed to take suitable steps to prevent a fall. The firm had been hired by the homeowner to move 9 solar panels higher up on the roof. At Swindon Magistrates Court, EE Renewables Limited of Saltearns Lane, Fareham, Hampshire, pleaded guilty to breaching the Health and Safety at Work Act and was fined £120,000 with £4,700 in costs. Still on solar, it's been revealed that mounting PV panels vertically during snowy winter months yields up to 4 times more power than laying them flat. The surprising finding was discovered by researchers in Norway acting on behalf of the Overeasy Solar Company. It's partly explained by snow cover on flat panels reducing their output, but the vertical panels also benefit from light reflected from the snow. Panels mounted vertically all year round can be up to 30% more efficient in a Scandinavian country with high snowfall, says the firm. Another benefit of vertical panels in snow conditions, the company claims, is the faster melting of snow around them. That's because the panel orientation promotes the mixing of warmer air into the snowy surface. Now, our first question of the week for 2025 was taken from our free training package made with Doncaster Cables on the subject of cables and conductors, and asked, when PVC cable is burnt, it gives off which gas? The correct answer is, of course, hydrogen chloride. And hang on to your hats, because while 57% of people on YouTube got the answer right, for the first time in a long time, LinkedIn participants showed a higher level of knowledge and 61% were correct over there. The Battle of the Platforms is back on for next week. In the meantime, head over to that free training package from Doncaster Cables to find out more nuggets of useful information. In product news this month, there's been a spate of recalls. The Office for Product Safety and Standards is warning the trade about a pair of electrical boots aimed at electricians. The Armour A18 Lightning boots are intended to provide protection against electrical hazards, but the office says that they do not meet the requirements of the regulations when used in electrical environments. It adds the risk of an electric shock is high. The product is only certified as a basic safety boot. Despite the withdrawal, EFIX found the footwear on open sale on websites which supply the trade. I've put a link to the official documents in the show notes so you can be fully informed before any purchase. Also being recalled this week is a range of Sangamo kit. Being voluntarily withdrawn is a series of power saver heating timers and fuse spurs. It includes 7-day, 24-hour and boost timers. Distributor ESP explains that it has identified a potential safety hazard with the product. It says a potential manufacturing defect may cause the units to overheat, particularly if they're used with a high load in a high ambient temperature. Any electrician who's installed one of the products in question is advised to isolate and replace it immediately. The company also says that as per IET guidance, 13 amp loads in high ambient temperature environments such as airing cupboards are not suitable to be supplied by standard 13 amp fuse spur products. In such cases, a 20 amp double pole switch unit should be used instead. The company says it can report that no damage or injuries have been reported at this time. I've put a list of the product codes in the show notes. Finally, in a bit of a gotcha moment, the Office for Product Safety and Standards has rejected a recessed ceiling light at the border. It says the LED luminaire presents a high risk of electric shock due to its inadequate insulation levels. The flying leads are simply connected to a terminal block, leaving metal parts insulated from live parts by basic insulation only. Should this basic insulation fail, accessible metal parts could become live, causing the user to receive an electric shock. The product also failed the electric strength test as the insulation broke down when the 3000 volt test voltage was applied. Additionally, some of the required documentation and markings are not present. Therefore, the product does not meet the requirements of the Electrical Equipment Safety Regulations of 2016. The product was put up for sale on Amazon before its rejection. If you're aware of any models that have made it into the UK, you're advised to contact your local trading standards office immediately. Again, I've listed the link to the PDF containing the model numbers and carton identifiers in the show notes. In business news, the LED group, which includes Robus and Fusebox, has bought the ATC group. Headquartered in Dublin, ATC is a renowned brand in energy-efficient electric heaters, hand dryers and automation controls. It was founded in 1991 and operates across the UK and Ireland. ATC will continue as an independent brand, but will benefit from the full backing of LED Group's extensive resources and support. And finally, a reminder that we're in the market for your stories, your projects and your recommendations, as we'd like to share them with the wider eFix community. Send us pictures of your installs or let us know if you've come across any new kit that's making your job easier. And just before we get to your favourite bit of the show where I reveal last week's challenge words and winners, we want to thank our premium partners. We couldn't make the news without you. First up, they're the people who've created the Swiss Army knife of solar inverters along with all-weather batteries. Very much the Boy Scouts of the solar industry, it's SunSync. And speaking of solar, with manufacturing powered by a 250 gigawatt solar PV array, they're literally the greenest test instrument maker in Europe, both physically and ethically, it's KPS. Are you a bit of a control freak? Motor control, that is. If so, with huge stocks and excellent service, check out Crompton Controls. As they said to me in a recent conversation, if we don't have it, then we can build it. And the best thing to come out of Yorkshire since stainless steel, the home of EV Ultra and other groundbreaking and quality products, it's Doncaster Cables. Big thanks to you all. We really appreciate your ongoing support for the news. If you think you know the words I've smuggled into this week's show, pop your guess into the comments. We'll take all the correct guesses and select one at random to be the winner of an eFix goodie bag prize. Answers submitted after about lunchtime on the Thursday after release will not be entered into the draw. Now let's reveal the winners of last week's challenge word competition. Last week's words were dunderhead and sycamore. That last being one of my favourite words, sycamore. Sycamore, it's lovely. Anyway, the first name to come out of our electronic hat was Dark22King. So very well done to you. Click the link in the show notes to claim your prize. Thanks for listening to this episode of Electrical News Weekly in association with Solar Trade Sales, your easy one-stop shop for all things solar. Remember to click the link in the show notes to check out their online shop. Make sure you subscribe to receive the next update. Thanks for listening, and until next time, have a great week. Stay safe out there, and remember, there's no such thing as a torque-calibrated arm.